Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You can be seated. Praise the Lord. And Sister Robbie is going to come and minister to us in song now, if you would. Yes? Huh? Okay. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. This is a prophetic nation, and we've got to remember that it is. God has his hand on this nation, and we play a very important part in evangelizing the world. And so we need to honor it. Amen. All right. Hallelujah. Wow. What a day it is. What a time it is. The Hebrew year started October 2nd, 5777. It's the three sevens, or the Hebrew word talks about the clashing of swords, the rattling of swords, and of course five is the number of grace, and so there's a mixture there. But how many of you have noticed there's been a little rattling of swords going on? Well, you might as well get used to it. Christianity is under attack. And the election didn't change that. In fact, all it did was incense the spirit of Antichrist. And it's going to get worse before it's going to get better. I'll try and give you the bad news first. But we're still more and more than ever facing our greatest danger, which is the spirit of Antichrist. And if you've read Revelation 13 or, you know, any of some of the prophets, you know that there is going to be a move by the spirit of Antichrist, by the beast, you know, that whole thing, that to take over the world and to have a one-world government. And when people start talking about one-world governance, you're hearing the devil's voice. I said, you're hearing the devil's voice. Okay? Unless they're saying Jesus is going to rule and reign throughout eternity as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Will the Antichrist arise and have his way? Yes, for a season. I happen to believe, I'm not an escapist, but I happen to believe the true believers will be gone. We'll be caught up in the air in what we call the rapture. And we won't be around for those horrible times. And they will be horrible, but people will still get saved. So if you get left behind, you'll have a second chance. That's always good news, isn't it? You know, what happens if I miss it? Well, that's all right. You can repent and, you know, maybe you'll be beheaded for the faith, but you'll make it. Isn't that exciting? Well, you know, we live in America, so we really don't realize that there are people all over the world that are facing that every day. And it's the spirit of Antichrist. You can say, well, it's ISIS. Well, that's the spirit of Antichrist. You can say, well, it's progressivism. Well, that's the spirit of Antichrist. You can say, well, it's socialism, it's Marxism, it's communism, it's all the spirit of Antichrist. They're all aligned against the truth of God's word. Amen. And that means they're aligned against you and against me. And that shouldn't scare us, because greater is he that is in us, amen, than he that is in the world. Okay, I don't know, I'm really... just not sure exactly how I'm going to go with this today. But, 1 John 2:18 says, little children, it's the last time. And as you've heard that the Antichrist shall come, even now there are many Antichrists, whereby we know that this is the last time. Don't monkey with that, honey. Do not monkey with that, honey. Praise the Lord. And... That's a no-no. That's a nay-nay. So, praise the Lord. We may have to just move that, until it gets in a place where it feels good about itself. It's kind of like some people, they need to get moved out of the world into Christ and the church so they'll feel better about themselves. Amen. Anyway, okay, so the spirit of Antichrist wants, well, we've already seen it, wants prayer out of schools. See, so it's not like he's just started working. He'd been working a long time. Wants prayer out of schools, wants prayer out of the public square, wants to take down all the crosses. Any mention of anything that even vaguely, remotely reminds them of Jesus, cross, Ten Commandments, whatever. They want people to live without a church home and a pastor. They want them to, preach these modernist preachers. They love it. They advocate sinful lifestyles, all that kind of a thing. It's just putrid. It's terrible. They encourage fornication. And that includes homosexuality. You know, I don't know why the homosexuals are so upset, because we're not, validating their lifestyle. It's fornication. It's the wrong way of doing things. God said, one man, one woman, and a marriage bed is undefiled. That's pretty simple, pretty clear. And anybody that violates that is actually violating the will and the way of God. And, it's just not going to be the best for them. The Antichrist wants abortion. You know, he just loves killing all these babies. It's a terrible thing. And, he loves self-centered lifestyles where people just are, they think that, their life, their little thing is more important than the things of God. And if you've succumbed to that, you need to get out of it. Because the spirit of Antichrist is absolutely terrified of a pure river of life-giving truth that flows from the Word of God. And polluted streams cloud the crystal clear truth of the gospel. And there's a lot of polluted streams today. Many think that President-elect Donald Trump is the modern version of Cyrus, the king of Persia, and that he's going to fix everything, or at least make it better for, Christianity. Well, there's different spins on that. One thing I do know is that because of this election, now the church has at least a 10-year window to proclaim the gospel in these last days all around the earth unhindered. And that's the way it should play out. I believe it will play out. And that's what that's what God is doing. He said, I'm going to give you an opportunity, church. I'm going to give you an opportunity now to wake up, to stand up, and to take back what the devil has stolen. See, and restore some things. We think, well, the Antichrist is coming anyway, the end of the age is coming anyway, it's going to be bad anyway. It will, when salt has lost its saltiness and when the light is dim or hidden under a bushel. See, the church has been shaken, awakened, and now the battle starts. See, A lot of Christians, they thought, by the way they voted, that just fixed everything. No, it just made it possible to fix some things. But if we think that a person, a man in the presidential office or his cabinet or anybody else is really going to fix things, we've got another thing coming. Because they will only fix things as they are led by the Spirit of the living God, and they actually operate according to biblical principle. And when they do that, our nation will return to one nation under God, which is its only value and its only purpose, is for us to be a people who are a light on the hill to the rest of the world, a place where there is freedom, because whom the Spirit sets free, whom Jesus sets free, that is the people that are free indeed. And that's us. And some have said, if America falls, where will we go? The rest of the world comes here for a reason. And it's the hope. And they come here, we're supposed to evangelize them. I said, we are supposed to evangelize them. We have to do that by opening our mouths and being a bold witness. And there will be a clashing of swords, right? The word of God is a sword. It proceedeth out of the mouth of God, that proceeds out of our mouth, the word of God, the sword of God, and it clashes with the swords of the world. But we've got to begin to express our faith in, how can I say this, in secular terms. In other words, we can't speak Christianese to people that don't understand our language. We have to be able to take the biblical concepts that God has taught us, the truth of the Word of God, and then begin to speak it in terms that the world can understand. And that can be done because they are principles that are unchanging. See, right is always right. The truth is always the truth. But there's a lot of different ways to express it. And that's what we have to learn to do, to meet people where they are and to talk to them, to dialogue, to let the swords clash. And of course, that has to go from our personal lives all the way up through every other influence, position of influence in the world. You know, I preached a little while ago about seven mountains. Well, that's not a new thing to me or something that, you know, I came up with. It's been around since, what I say, 1975. When they started talking about the seven mountains of influence that we need to take back. Well, how do you do that? By being the light and being the salt, wherever you work, wherever you shop, wherever you are and you can influence, could be your family. Thank God for that. You know, we're seeing that all the time, where families are being impacted and their whole philosophy of life, their whole way of looking at God and at Christ changes because of your life. The way you're walking things out, the way you're talking about things. That's what I'm talking about. And, you know, a lot of people fear Trump, fear the whole administration. They don't understand how God has and will use him for any value or any purpose. I mean, some of us are excited about it and some of us aren't. But the simple truth is that it's only as the administration yields to the Word of God, the principles of God, that anything of any real significance or meaning is going to take place. Well, a lot of that is going to come from you and I staying on top of what they're doing up on the Hill. See, we're supposed to tell our congressmen how we want them to vote, to act, to administrate, because we, the people, are actually who are supposed to be running this country, not them up there. So we'll see how that goes. But it's in God. And God has heard our prayers. He said, if my people, not the whole world, but if my people will just humble themselves, turn from their wicked ways and pray, I'll heal their land. Well, now we have a beginning to be able to do that. But it's going to be up to you and I. And the battle's going to be fierce. Don't think it's not. It already is. I mean, there have been horrible decisions made to come against Israel and Jerusalem. Boy, that is dumb, because those that bless Israel are blessed and those that curse are cursed. And thank God that this nation's not going to be cursed for what an outgoing administration has done. I think I have to tip my hat even to the leaders of, well, like Putin. It's like he chuckled a couple of times. He said, well, I'm not going to react to all of the sanctions and those kinds of things. I'm just going to wait for the new administration. You know, Netanyahu said the same thing. We have secrets. We have proof. We're not even going to bother giving them to you people right now. We're going to wait till the new administration's in, then we'll share them and they can share with the people or not. I mean, there's a whole lot of things that are going on that if you just look at it from a political viewpoint, you miss the whole point. Because the whole point is to allow the church to flourish. The Antichrist wants to crush it and push us clear out of the world and set up a one world governance so the Antichrist can easily step into place. See, if you're not looking at that, you're missing the whole point. But we're here to help preserve until the fullness of time, until everybody that can be saved is saved, because God would that none be lost. Isn't that precious? It really is. See, so the first great danger that we face is the spirit of Antichrist in every area, in education, in religion, in yes, religion. We've got to straighten up the house of God. I've got a great, you know, it's just, boy, the churches are sick, most of them. There's a lot of good ones, but there's a lot of sickness too. And, you know, education, got to be reformed, got to be changed. Well, that's going to take Christian teachers, isn't it? Thank God, every time I hear about a young person that wants to become a teacher, that's a Christian, I just go, I about dance, man, because this is what we need. And those kinds of things. We need Christian politicians. Amen. You know, that may sound like an oxymoron, but it's really not. But, you know, maybe it is. Maybe I should say what we need are Christian public servants. Amen? Amen. And so, you know, everybody, you know, I'm studying, taking a class on U.S. Constitution, U.S. government from Hillsdale, and one of the things they said, there were three major crises in our country. The first one was the Revolutionary War. The second one was the Civil War. The third one is progressivism, and we're still in that war. You know, progress is supposed to mean you're making progress, not regress. Progressivism should mean that we are moving toward the high calling of Jesus Christ, not moving away from God and, you know, trying to set up a world governance where just a few elitists can tell everybody else what they're supposed to do and how they're supposed to live and what they're supposed to eat. And I don't know about you, I like being an American. I like being free, saying what I want to say when I want to say it. And that's just, I hope you're the same way, to have the opportunity to try, even if you fail. You know, that's why I always like being in business. It wasn't so much about, well, will I be a success? Of course, that's the plan. But the bottom line was, it really didn't matter, because I enjoyed the race. I enjoyed the challenge. You know, I enjoyed having the privilege of being able to give it a go and to learn so that the next time I could do better. If, you know, if that didn't work out. And so, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But, you know, every ideology, whether it's communism or Marxism or, you know, Islamofascism or whatever it is, it's all designed to have a dictator who rules over the people. And we've got to see that difference. And, you know, whether it's a greedy, power-hungry man, woman with a God complex, or an Islamic leader who wants to be the caliph of the Islamic caliphate, the nation are still facing the choice to be a nation of kings and priests under Christ Jesus, the King of Kings, or become like all other nations and eventually yield our sovereignty under God to the Antichrist or to some other power. I was very disturbed when I heard our president say in one of his speeches, well, America, the United States, is just going to have to give some of its sovereignty away to the UN. And I said, no. See, because owning property and national borders are actually very clear in the Bible. God gave his people certain portions of land for each tribe. And so on, you know. It's just, that's the way it is. And the lie that a larger government will take care of you without you having to work is a devil-instituted deception, believe me. My source is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he's done real well for me up till now. And a king is not our source. God is our source. And if you want a verse for that, you know, 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 6 through 20. 1 Samuel chapter 8. 6 through 20. I won't take the time to read it, but it talks about that. And, you know, in Acts chapter 5, verse 1 through 4, of course, the story of Ananias and Sapphira is the same thing. It's basically the bottom line, besides them lying against God, which was not too cool. But the bottom line was they had a right to their own property to do with it what they wished. They didn't have to do anything with it. And certainly not lie about what they were going to do with what they had. So withholding from God, lying to him by saying, I can't afford to tithe, or saying, I tithe, when you hold back some of it, is just going to bring increasing judgment in 2017. And I hope you're smarter than that already. Because Mark Barclay, Dr. Mark Barclay said, you cannot have the grace of God without the God of grace. And so we need to be obedient to God, and then we receive his grace. We can't serve God and mammon. And mammon is a spirit. It's not money. It's a spirit of greed, of lust, of those kinds of things. There's a whole series of demons that go along with that. And you can't serve one and God. There's no way to do that. You're gonna choose one or the other. And that's really what we're facing as a people, as Christians. We're either going to serve God, and we're going to do it with all of our heart, all of our mind, all of our strength, or we're going to wind up getting just steamrolled over by the spirit of Antichrist. And I don't want that for my kids, grandkids, great-grandkids, anybody else. You know, I want them to grow up free. I'd like to see them be able to grow up as free as I did when I was a kid. See? I mean, they don't even have that now. But we can take it back. But each of us is going to have to do our part. That's why we need a fresh anointing. We need to realize who we are, whose we are, and who we are. We are kings and priests. We're a royal priesthood. We're a holy nation, which takes precedent, yes, over the nation of the United States or the nation, any other nation. We're first and foremost ambassadors sent from heaven. See? And we represent the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And to be, you know, just to please people, to be quiet because we think we'll offend them, is an offense to God. We can't be man-pleasers and God-pleasers at the same time. But we can not be silent. Don't be the silence of the lambs kind of a person, you know. I mean, just we've got to become a people who learn to speak up what we believe, say what we believe, but say it in a way that doesn't sound religious. Really? Yeah, that just takes a little study, a little practice. Get rid of the Christianese. See? And find other ways to say the right things to help people change their concept. Dr. Robert Cornwall one time preached for us here, and he said when I preach a sermon, he says, I'm not trying to, you know, I'm not even thinking or hoping that everybody's going to just remember everything I said. He said, all I want to do is change one concept. If I can just change one concept of truth, it'll be a building block for more truth. And that's what you and I need to do, is to help people think through some of these things that are going on in our world today. I found a great new way to engage teenagers. And for somebody that's my age, that's pretty amazing. But it's on social media. And I find if I just make myself available, let's start asking questions. You know, first they'll say, boy, you're old. You know, what are you doing on here? It's interesting. But then when it gets down to it, and I'll share a little bit about life, and they start asking questions about why should we be married? You know, how come? You know, animals can have, offspring without being married. Why do people need to be married? Well, that's a pretty good question, isn't it? For a teenager to come up with. And, what's wrong with homosexuality? You know, is that a problem? And all kinds of questions about life, work, all of that. And I'm just having a grand old time because they're actually listening. They're interested. They want somebody to tell them what they're supposed to be thinking, because in the schools and the universities, they're telling them that America is one of the most horrible places in the world to possibly be in, that our history is so ugly, so nasty, so terrible that we shouldn't even want to be a part of it. We ought to stomp on the flag and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And that people who are of faith are just, they need a crutch, and they're so emotionally disturbed and messed up, you know, you don't want anything to do with them. Well, somebody... And the schools have them for more time than the parents do. Sure, a lot more time than the church does, it seems. And so somehow we've got to engage them where they are and talk to them about things that are actually very, very, very important to the future, their future and the future of the world. But praise God, the church arose, the church prayed, God answered. Some people didn't like the answer. Some people did. Huh? But see, here's the thing. Where people thought that the election was going to make everything peaceful, it began the war. I don't like to say it, but in my spirit, I see blood flowing in the streets. I don't like to see that. Because it's going to get so heated and so pitched. It's already the slander, the maligning, the character assassination, the questioning everything. It's just so heating up. I'm trying to bait Russia into a war, trying to, you know, increase racial prejudice and strife, it's just on every hand, and we've got to step into that with the truth and love and say, we're not going there, and you don't have to either. You can hate me, but I'm going to love you because Christ loves you, and there's nothing we can't fix if we'll just talk about it. So let's talk. Amen. And don't be afraid of that. You know, none of us has all the answers that people are, but one thing I found out, most people are asking the same basic questions. Why am I here? What's my purpose? How did I get here? Where am I going? You know, it's once you get the, you know, after a while, it's like you're just waiting for the question because it's coming. And so it's pretty simple to talk to people. So the arrogance of Antichrist leaders, and you have to understand, there can be good people, brilliant people, actually, in a certain way, and yet so deceived spiritually, clouded by the spirit of Antichrist, that they're just leading people in the wrong direction. And that's what we're for. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. I mean, they're going to fall like Herod fell, one by one. They'll stand up, they'll tell you how great they are, and God will say, that's the last time you're going to say that. And that'll be the end of that. And you'll see that. You'll see arrogant anti-Christian leaders, anti-Christ leaders fall in a moment. They'll be heard of no more. History will move on. Praise the Lord. But see, the blessing is that Christians are arising, they are praying, and they are getting involved in civic and political process. And when the righteous are in authority, Proverbs 29:2 says, the people rejoice. I mean, this is a no-brainer thing. Christianity is what brings freedom, liberty, righteousness, peace, joy, right? And so we really need to stand up for it and need to. We need to. And we're not going to see a settling in a peace in our country probably until Passover, Easter time. It's going to take some time. And so you're going to see things, hear things, and it's going to be unnerving. You know, like in Istanbul. I mean, somebody went in there and killed 35 people, wounded 70 or something. I don't know. Those kind of things are going to happen. Thank God New Year's Eve was peaceful here. A lot of people praying. And we thank God for our first responders, our police, our anti-terrorism people. But, you know, we have to be diligent. We have to keep praying. And we need to watch these organizations that are being funded by George Soros and people like him that want the sovereignty of the United States destroyed, the people's freedom stripped from them, and a one-world government put into place. And the only way we're going to do it is with the clashing of the sword, the word of God in our mouths as we engage society, which is what Christianity has not done. We've backed out of society. We just, well, okay, you know, whatever. It's kind of an Americanism. I'm okay, you're okay, you know. I want you to be free, and so you just be what you are. But we've taken that to almost condone what's going on. And we need to step back in and say, well, you know, here's the reason that this, the way you're thinking, the way you're going, is not going to work. Why it doesn't work. And some wonderful things will happen. It's going to be a great battle to take back education, to take back religion, to take back government. It's not over. But you're going to, if the church will do what the church is supposed to do, which is become vocal, okay, whether it's politically or whether it's just engaging society, become vocal, stay vocal, then you know, we'll begin to see some progress. It's nothing happens overnight. Nothing gets fixed overnight. You understand that? And we're always wanting to separate the spiritual, you know, from the practical. We need to get into the presence of God. That's why we're going to fast for 21 days. I hope you'll all do that. You know, I'm going to be, you know, I won't even look at bread, donuts, any of that stuff. It's gone for 21 days, and that's my addiction, actually. You know, and other things that I'm going to lay aside so I can spend more time with God, more time in God's presence, and really hope to have some real connection and a spiritual experience with God, so that I know better how to move forward through this next year. But if I don't put those things into action, they're useless. It doesn't matter how much I prophesy in church. If I can't go out on the street and have a word for the world, there's a problem. See what I'm saying? So whether it's at our workplace or wherever it is, we need to take our connection with God and then somehow share that with others. Praise the Lord. So we've got to take these areas, religion, family, education, government, media, arts, entertainment, business, take them back. And this is not a new thing. This goes, I mean, you saw the same thing with Jehoram and that whole thing. Amen. But don't give up on America. You know, what I see ahead, I told you, is great social and political unrest. I see the race card being played hard to try and divide, you know. And so what am I going to do? Just for an example, what I'm going to do is show up at every event on the West Side I can. You know, there's a tremendous black population over there. And I will be there. I'm welcome there. People know me there. You know, I mean, I'm not welcome everywhere, but, you know. But when I hear there's something going on, I can be there. I will be there as a representative of somebody that's, you know, just a little lighter than maybe they are. I was at a prayer meeting on Saturday, and I had everybody's cologne on me. It's wonderful. I'd never been hugged so much in my life, because I hadn't seen some of those people in quite some time. That may not sound like much, but you know what? It means a lot. Or how about a Jewish event? They have some tremendous things going on in their cultural center, concerts and plays and informational things. And for a Gentile to show up there just sends them over the top. They can't believe we'd actually be interested. That's why I belong to CUFI, the Christians United for Israel, because we're making an impact and we're getting rid of the divide, see, and because now there is such a huge organization, over 3.5 million people now belong to CUFI, and we're hammering Congress to stand with Israel, and you can see that the spirit of Antichrist is still trying to drive a wedge in there, but they're smart enough to know that is not the heart of the American people. See, that's what we have to do, is be a people that show that not everybody up there speaks for us. Amen? So that's kind of the way things are going. But there's going to be violence, there's going to be unrest, and of course there's the formation of a shadow government that I've never heard of such a thing, but all of that will be going on, where there's going to be a lot of hard work by those that feel that they've been robbed of their legacy to try and, you know, keep the status quo and to keep Christianity and Judaism pushed down. And there's a call already to violently oppose the rule of law. Individuals and entities will be slandered, maligned, even physically threatened and attacked. That's already begun. It's only going to get worse. We're going to see riots and blood in the streets before godly order is restored. That's not going to be fun. It's not. And the stories that surround it and swirl, the spirit of fear is going to go to work like never before. And we must remember that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. You know, and just don't allow fear to step in. You know, and just step through whatever walls where you meet somebody who's afraid. You've got a tremendous job on your hands to take love of God and press through that to where they can receive it. Amen. And so we need to do that. And the spirit of fear is the main ally of the spirit of Antichrist. We get people being afraid of us fanatics. That's crazy people, right, who believe in God. And so you're only going to really understand what's really going on if you can ignore the fear mongers and stay in tune with the spirit of God. There's not going to be any room for self-serving considerations. In other words, you and I have to get out of ourselves. Jesus did not come to the cross, you know, come to earth and suffer what he suffered and go to the cross, bleed, give up his life there for just so we could live better. Amen. That's a lie. It really is. He called us to come alongside him for the sake of humanity. And to reach out, not just materially, we should do that. But I'll tell you, if we ever give a crumb of bread, it should be in the name of Jesus. You know, whatever we do should raise him up, glorify him, praise God. And it's so simple to do. It really is. To be able to just, you know, I mean, it's one thing to give somebody a buck or some food when you're, you know, they're on the corner trying to, you know, get something with their homeless sign and you just throw some money at them and drive off. It's another thing to stop with a homeless person and hear their story and talk to them about the love of God. Well, you know, there's rich people that are in just as big a mess. They just live better. And they need to hear us and they need to know we care. So the self-serving has got to go. We've got to become the disciples of Christ. And when darkness gets darker, the light must shine brighter. It will, if we'll allow it. Praise the Lord. So stay informed, stay connected, stay active. You know, the thief, John 10:10, cometh not but for to steal, kill, and destroy, but I'm come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Don't give up on America. Don't give up on yourself. Don't give up on America. You know, another question the kids have is, why can't I just get a trophy and not even show up? Why can't I get an A in school and not do my studies? What's the problem with that? Well, that sounds like a no-brainer probably to most of us here, but these are questions they have because this is what they're being taught. You're a champion. See, you're a hero. And they haven't done anything. I mean, come on, you know, we're overcomers, but that tells me we have to overcome something. We're more than conquerors, which means we have to conquer something. Huh? It's one thing for God to see us that way. It's something else for us to move into how he sees us. See, I can't just claim I'm an overcomer and I haven't done a thing. You know, anyway, okay. So, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to listen to this now. I assume you've been listening to what I've said so far, but I want you to listen. Praise God. And this is, I'm going to read you a prophecy that was given by the late Glenn Foster, who was very, very important in sharing in my lives and prophesied over us and imparted a mantle to us. And But it's really interesting because prophecy has a timelessness about it. And I think this will help kind of pull us into where we need to be, I pray. Throughout history, when mockers and scoffers increased and when the land was filled. Now remember, this was God speaking through him. And these words are still active. They're still alive. They're still powerful. They're still prophetic. Throughout history, when mockers and scoffers increased, when the land was filled with the pollution of the unbelieving, God always did unusual things. God has always shown special miracles, special gifts, and demonstrations of his Spirit, and his wisdom and his power to deliver his people. In Noah's day, when violence filled the land, when mockers and scoffers were everywhere, the imagination of men's hearts were evil. Gosh, they could be talking about today, couldn't they? Behold, the Lord stretched forth his hand and with great wonders delivered the believing. Woo! He brought them forth in his power, established them under his covenant, and put the rainbow in the heavens, which has remained until this day. In the days of Moses, when blasphemy was great and the Pharaoh of Egypt put forth his hand to slay the children of Israel and stop their growth, their faith in Almighty God, I stretched forth my hand in 10 mighty plagues. I broke Pharaoh before my might and my power. I buried his chariots of steel and horses of iron in the depths of the sea. Even in the days of Jehoshaphat, with great armies came against Israel, I confounded them with my wisdom. I didn't send my champion archers or swordsmen or those who were skillful with the shield. I didn't send the horsemen or chariots. I sent the praisers. Without sword, spear, or bow, without horse or chariot, I sent the choirs of Israel with the glory of the Lord in their midst, with special miracles. I smote the enemy armies, and 3 days my people picked up the spoils. Get ready to pick up your spoil. As the enemies flee, you'll be the benefactor. I mean, we've been promised economic increase, but watch and see what the Lord will do with thee. Amen. In the days of the first apostles, when Christians were being martyred on the right hand and the left, I sent angels to bring them out of prison. I sent my power to do great signs and wonders and special miracles until people were healed in the streets. Get ready, get ready. Get ready. If you will yield to the Spirit of God and begin to engage society, God will begin to do great signs, wonders, and miracles by your hands. And if you don't think that'll crank your excitement for Christianity up, you're sadly mistaken. I'll tell you, it's awesome. Until the very shadows of the apostle falling on the lame caused him to walk. How would you like that? You walk by, your shadow just passes over somebody and they're instantly healed. I'm saying expect it. Because God has already spoken to me about these kinds of things coming in this awakening, in this decade of harvest. And those who will step in and will walk with God are going to walk in the supernatural like they never thought possible, and you're not going to have to act spooky at all. I don't like spooky. You know, some people, I mean, I just, wow. But well, the real stuff, I love it. Okay. I'm the same God yesterday, today, and forever. I've taken notice of the scoffers. I've seen and heard the blasphemers, and the stench has come up into my nostrils. But I've not said that I'll banish them into eternal fire. Rather, I have said, once again, I will stretch forth my hand and lay bare my holy arm in the eyes of the nations so that the unbelieving will see and know that I am a great God, a merciful God, a God who delivers his people. God is still trying to reach those that are the most stiff-necked and hard-hearted toward him. I bring you to the brazen altar, and I open your eyes and touch your heart, for this is the hour of new beginnings. The hour in which I give you eyes to see, ears to hear, a heart to understand. I give you feet that are ready to run the path that I've set before you. Hands that are strong to work the works of him who sent you. For this is a day of might and power and demonstration in the Holy Spirit. Think about it. Surely this is the hour, my people, when the Holy Spirit will grace your lives as the dove came upon Christ when he came up out of the waters. Even now my spirit is settling down on the yielding sacrifice. We're living sacrifices, remember. Come, meet me at the altar. I'll walk with you many days in a way beyond your ordinary experience, for I've called a holy convocation where my people will come and seek my face. On the day that my apostles stood gazing up into heaven, I said to them, behold, I go away. But if I go away, I will pray to the Father, and he'll send you another, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. My Father will send him in my name. And I gave my apostles these instructions. Go into Jerusalem, tarry until you're endued with power from on high. My people, it's time to put your calendars aside. It's time to put your plans and wishes aside. It's time to hear the voice that speaks from heaven. For it is written, God spoke to man from heaven. And you carry these words in your soul. Come inside, lay aside the burdens, lay aside the toil, the fears, lay aside your fretting and frustration. That's what the 21 days of fasting is for. Prostrate yourself before the Lord and wait at the feet of the Lamb of God. Take hold of the nail-pierced feet and say, Lord, I will not let you go till you bless me. And then I will pray the Father. He will send the Holy Spirit in a new wave of revival and visitation and a new dimension and demonstration of the power of the Lord your God. There will be mighty signs and wonders. Wonderful oracles of God will be heard. The voice of the Almighty will be sweet, but it will also be as thunder. And when the word of the Lord will be as coals of fire and also as bolts of lightning, and the throne of the Lamb and of God will be in the midst thereof. People will come from the ends of the earth to receive from the Lord. They'll come to be healed. They'll come to be set free, released from bondage, to comprehend what God is doing in these days. No more will you say, who am I? And what is this that the Lord does? But you will say, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It will come to pass in the last days. I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. And now I've said, no longer will sickness go unchallenged in your midst, and sickness will no longer prevail over you. I, the Lord, will step forth in your midst. I will challenge your diseases. I will break their yokes. And I will step forth in your midst for special gifts and miracles of the Holy Spirit. I'll begin to lead as I stir my people to believe me for financial miracles, to believe me for deliverance. I'll rescue you, says the Lord, out of the hand of your pharaohs, of those who have said, as they did to Noah, where is your flood? Where is your God? Look at your ark. You build it for nothing. Behold, the day is now at hand when scoffers will no longer say to you, where is your God? Where are the things that you've declared he will do? Multitudes will come and worship at my feet. They will say, we have seen the hand of the Lord working mightily in the land. Draw near, my children, for this is your hour. Let me put my arms around you, for I am ready to do great things. Let me comfort and encourage you. Are you ready to receive them? Open your heart. Come around my altar. Wait on me in times of prayer and worship, and think within your innermost being This is my appointed hour, for the Lord has come down to visit me. The Lord has come down to visit me. Say that. The Lord has come down to visit me. Say it. He's talking about you. The Lord has come down to visit me. Oh, hallelujah. I want you to come to the altar. Sharon and I want to anoint you. It's a new season. It's a new day. A fresh anointing is coming your way. A season of power and prosperity. It's a new season. It's a new day. Hi, I'm Pastor George Stover, and I want to invite you to come and join with us as we build the kingdom of God at Wellspring Church of All Nations. We're located at 8140 West Lone Mountain Road. There's also an entrance off of 4870 Janelle Drive. There is nothing more important to you and I today than the Word of God. If we don't learn as a people, as a nation, to return to the Bible, to return to faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone, we're not going to have the country that we've had, the one that I grew up in. I want my grandchildren and my children, your children and your grandchildren, to live in the America I grew up in. But you know, it's going to depend on us, the people of faith. We have to get into the Word and just stick with it. And having done all, stand. And so we're really, really wanting you to come and just be a part of who we are, what we're doing here, because it's really all about you.